Just take your seats in heavenly places. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord. I want to celebrate the angel of the house with the first lady. I want to... Amen. Amen. It's not easy to be a pastor in this Android generation where people are looking for miracles.com and poverty.go. Amen. I want to thank God for the grace of God upon their lives, their humility, and I want to particularly celebrate the fact that they can trust me with their pulpit, that I'm going to pull people out of the pit, not put people into the pit. Amen. I bless God for your life, man of God. And God is going to take you far. Amen. For there are so many things that God has in store. And this conference is just the beginning of it all. Amen. Because the Lord showed me that he has given you a key. A key that will again open an ancient door that had been closed by religion. There is an ancient door that was opened many years ago that is now closed by traditions of men and by religion. But there is a key in your hand that will again open that ancient door, and people will find their way to the ancient path, and that the original purpose of the revival will come. And that in this season, that the hand of the Lord will bring succor unto you. Amen. Supernatural help and strength from above. Amen. And thus says the Lord unto you, your help cometh. Amen. Your help cometh. Amen. From above. Thank you, Holy Spirit. God will expand you to the north, to the south, and the east, and the west. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your blessing. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for everyone present under the sound of my voice tonight. Let our hearts be open. Let no human soul remain the same. We arrest principalities and powers in the atmosphere of Tulsa. We decree and declare, let the will of God be superimposed. We overrule, we cancel demonic verdicts from the pit of hell concerning this city, concerning this town, concerning this state. We cancel in the name of Yeshua. We bring to naught every counsel of the wicked, and we exalt the horn of your anointed, and we declare, let the voice of God be heard. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. And that from this church let rivers of water flow. Amen. Rivers of life flow. Amen. And let every member of this parish, every member of this spiritual family, be equipped, be divinely fortified. Amen. Let weaknesses turn into strength. Amen. Let shame turn into honor. Amen. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. Thank you, Father. Let your word in my mouth come forth. Let it bring healing, deliverance. Let the people on the look at me, let them not see me. Let them see Jesus. And let Christ be manifested today. Take away self and take away every aggrandizement of man. And let the name of Jesus be praised. In Jesus' name we pray. Shout a better amen. Amen. Clap for him. Take your seat. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. From the beginning of this conference, God has been doing awesome things. How many of you believe he has been doing awesome things? Hallelujah. And on my way to this place, I lost my bags. None of them arrived. I just had the clothes that I came with from Africa where God lives. You know, God lives in Africa. He only visits America. It was a sign to me that God was going to start something new in this conference. And I know that after this, your life cannot be the same. So we've been prophesying from the first day. God has been doing awesome things. But I perceive in my spirit that tonight we are going to enter a dimension that God is going to be moving a lot in the healing. According to what he told me, there's going to be supernatural healing tonight. And there'll be manifestation of signs. So you get ready and let your faith be connected. It is not by might, it's not by power, it's by the Spirit of the living God. Shout a better hallelujah. I want to celebrate the presence of the man of God that is here today. I celebrate you, man of God. Thank you very much for coming. Amen. So we've been looking at the gospel of Christ that has been communicated to us right from the beginning. We looked at the constellations from Virgo to Leo. We saw how the gospel was concealed in the heavens and was now translated into a format that human beings can understand. Hallelujah. We looked at the significance of the number 12. And yesterday we also saw the first prophecy that was given concerning the seed of the woman crushing the head of the serpent. And we also saw yesterday that we are the hupanikumai. Any hupanikumai here? Now, in case you just joined us and you don't understand what we are talking about, I think the CDs or the DVDs will be available for you to get so you can catch up with what God has been doing from the beginning of the conference. And yesterday we also saw that we are kings that will reign without battles because of the victory of our Father. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. But tonight God would be teaching us on what I call the law of the seventh day, which is the law of rest. Because I believe that by the anointing of God, you are going to have rest. Any one of you that has been going through strange battles and difficulties, after today you will find a chair and sit down. Amen. Touch your neighbor and tell him you need to sit down. Look for a better neighbor. That neighbor was not too good. Say you need to sit down. If it's a brother, say bro, you need to sit down, bro. Every major revelation finds its origin in the book of Genesis and its completion in the book of Revelation. Hallelujah. And so we're going to go to Genesis. If you've been a keen observer, you realize most of my teachings begin from Genesis because it's a new beginning. Genesis chapter number 2 from verse 1. Genesis chapter number 2 from verse 1. I would like a microphone to be given to any brother or any sister who can be reading out the scripture for me. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You can sit down. Just sit down. There are many scriptures you'll be reading. Go ahead.
Start.
From verse
Genesis
1 to 3.
2 verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made.
Hallelujah. Amen. The heavens and the earth were finished. Come on, say finished. And all the host of them. And on the seventh day. Come on, say seven. On the seventh day, God ended his works. He finished his works. He completed his works. And the Bible says, and God rested. If God can rest, it is ungodly not to rest. That means that rest is a function of godliness. When you are godly, you need to learn to rest. Because God, who is your father, even God rested. There are many people who walk like elephants and eat like ants. That is to say, they don't enjoy the fruits of their labor. They work more than they enjoy what they work for. But God sent me all the way from Africa, where God lives, to come and tell you that it's time for you to enter your rest. Amen. And to enjoy the benefits for which Jesus had died. You see, Christianity should have a different definition than what we have known. Christianity is the application. This is my definition, and I think it's the best because it came from the Holy Spirit. Nobody said a good amen there. Amen. Christianity is the application of the finished works of Christ. Amen. Amen. It's the application of the finished works of Christ. That is why my message is centered around Christology. Everything you see in the teachings that we receive is centered around Christ because he's the center of it all. And Christology is the study of the loveliness of his person and the perfection of his works. Hallelujah. And the Bible says that God rested on the seventh day from all his works. In scripture, numbers have significance. I almost spoke in French. Amen. Numbers have significance. Numerology, according to the scripture, every number has a significance. We all know, many people know, most of us know that seven is the number of perfection, completion, rest. We looked at the genealogy of Adam yesterday, and it ended with Noah before the flood. And we said that Noah means rest, comfort, peace, enjoyment. Hallelujah. And when God finished, he blessed the seventh day. He sanctified it, for in it he rested. So there are four things here. The seventh day is a day of rest, is a day of the finished works, is a blessed day, and it's a sanctified day. Shout amen if you hear me now. Amen. That's what is called the law of first mention. The law of first mention simply means that when you see a number in the Bible, trace to find out where it was first mentioned, get the application, and that defines what that number would stand for throughout scripture. So from this is the first time we see the number seven in the Bible, and throughout the scripture, the number seven will represent rest. It will represent perfection. It will represent completion. Shout amen if you're following me. And so God introduces a principle called the principle of rest, which is the principle of the Sabbath. But you see, everything that God begins in Genesis is never the conclusion. It's the initiation. Even Adam, like we saw yesterday, that Adam was the raw material for God to make man in his image. Adam was not the finished product. But in the realms of the spirit, God had already finished all his works. And he began to introduce into the natural dimension what he had already completed in the spiritual dimension. So Adam was the starting point, but Jesus was the finish point. So when God rested on the seventh day, it sparked up a principle of rest whenever the number seven shows up. And I prophesy in your life that before it is 72 hours, within the next 3 days, you would experience supernatural peace and rest in your finances, in your relationships, in your jobs, in your body, in your health, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Lift your right hand and shout hallelujah. And so God begins to introduce this principle of rest. And he puts it in the law. And he gives it to Moses. And the second time we'll find this number appearing in this light is in Exodus chapter 20 verse 8. Exodus 20 verse 8. You read from verse 8 to 11. Exodus 20 verse 8 to 11. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days thou shalt labor, and thou shalt do all thy work. You shall work and labor 6 days. Yes, are you there? Yes. Can you read it?
But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God.
Yes.
In it you shall do no work.
Yes.
You, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates.
Yes.
For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth,
yes,
the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
Shout a good amen.
Amen.
Now, this is the law. When the Sabbath comes, you would have to rest, including your helpmates, your maid servants, your men servants, and your animals. America has a lot of dogs. I see a lot of security dogs around. But the Bible says that on the Sabbath day, even the dog has to rest. No security for you that day. You have to keep the dog in his house. And you would have to trust God to protect you. So in the Sabbath day, even the animals had to rest. If you had a donkey that helps you in the farm, on the Sabbath day, the donkey would have to rest, and you would have to trust God for what to eat. You would have to believe God to secure your home from thieves and armed robbers. You would have to trust God to supply help from above. It was a time where you had to experience the supernatural. The Sabbath was a day to activate supernatural help. Supernatural provision, supernatural manifestation. That is to say that if you had security dogs that mounted guard physically against physical assaults, when the Sabbath came, you had to trust God for a physical manifestation from heaven to protect your physical home. That is to say, you had to tap into the supernatural and depend on the invisible. So it was a test of their faith. Asking them to rest on the seventh day was a test of their faith. You needed to believe to experience the rest of God. But if you didn't have faith, and if you could not believe, when the Sabbath came, you'd be panicking. Because you can't sleep, you just go. You keep checking. You know, your dog is not supposed to be on duty. Your dog is supposed to be resting. The Bible says even your animals had to rest. And so if you'd never had faith and you couldn't believe God, you'd be panicking and you would be doing the work that God himself should be doing for you. You're not hearing what I'm saying now. So the Sabbath was a test of their faith and their belief in God. Amen.
Amen.
Huh. And the Bible says that even your men servants and your maid servants had to rest. Everybody had to rest, find a chair and sit down, or get a bed and lie down, because that was the law. And the penalty for not keeping the Sabbath was death. You had to be stoned. You had to die. Death was the outcome for not obeying the law of rest, because God himself rested and it has become a law. Go to Leviticus chapter 25 verse 2. Leviticus 25 verse 2. And Exodus 23 from verse 10 to 12.
Leviticus 25 and 2.
Yes.
Speak to the children of Israel and say to them,
yes,
when you come into the land which I give you,
yes,
then the land shall keep a Sabbath to
the
Lord.
The land shall keep a Sabbath. Yes.
6 years you shall sow your field, and 6 years you shall prune your vineyard and gather its fruits. But in the seventh year there shall be a Sabbath of solemn rest for the land, a Sabbath to the Lord.
Yes.
You shall neither sow your field nor prune your vineyard. What grows of its own accord of your harvest you shall not reap, nor gather the grapes of your untended vine, for it is a year of rest for the land.
It's a year of rest for the land. What are you going to eat for 1 year? Your land is going to rest for a year. You can cultivate for 6 years, but in the seventh year, your land must rest. How are you going to survive for 1 year without cultivation? So the Sabbath was a time where you needed to activate your faith, to trust God to provide for you. Say good amen.
Amen.
Just follow me. I'm taking you somewhere with this. Exodus 23, verse 10.
Exodus 23 and 10. 6 years you shall sow your land and gather in its produce, but the seventh year you shall let it rest and lie fallow, that the poor of your people may eat, and that what they leave the beast of the field may eat. In like manner, you shall do with your vineyard and your olive grove. 6 days you shall do your work, and on the seventh day you shall rest, that your ox and your donkey may rest, and the son of your female servant and the stranger may be refreshed.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. So this was a law which God passed. Because from Genesis 2, he rested. And so he says that all my people must experience the Sabbath and they must rest. And they must learn to trust me when it is time to rest. Amen. The priests, who were the descendants of Levi, were supposed to implement this law. They were supposed to reinforce the laws of God. That was the job of the priest, to make sure that the law was followed. They had to implement it. Hallelujah. The high priest came from the tribe of Levi, and it was his duty to do the intercession, to reinforce the law, and to make sure that it was followed. But however, something happened to these people. In the book of Hebrews chapter 3 from verse 10, we see that the Bible says that Israel did not enter God's rest. They didn't enter into God's rest. The Bible actually says that Joshua did not lead them into the promised land. Now you'll be wondering, what is Canaan and what's the promised land? We know Moses took them out and Joshua took them in. But here the Bible is revealing to us in the book of Hebrews chapter 3 and chapter 4 that Israel did not get in. They didn't get into God's rest. They didn't enjoy the Sabbath. Why? Because of unbelief. Can you read it for me, sister? Hebrews 3.
Therefore, I was angry with that generation.
Yes.
They always go astray in their heart.
Yes.
And that they have not known my ways.
Yes.
So I swore in my wrath.
I swore in my anger.
They shall not enter my rest.
Yes.
Beware, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from
the living God. Evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But go to verse 17.
Now, with whom was he angry 40 years?
Yes.
Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell Kabo in the wilderness? Shadabaya. And to whom did he swear that he would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So we see that we could not enter in because of unbelief.
They could not enter in because of unbelief. They were restless. Busy generation, working and working, and they couldn't experience the Sabbath of the Lord. They entered into Canaan, but they did not enter into rest because of unbelief. Because of unbelief. They couldn't, and God swore that they wouldn't enter it. And the Bible says, now therefore remaineth a rest for the people of God. God preserved something for a generation yet to come. God said, this rest, this Sabbath, which this generation did not get, I will keep it and preserve it for a generation that can have faith.
Amen.
And so, he sends Jesus. But before Jesus comes, the man by the name John the Baptist had to precede him. And John the Baptist came from the tribe of Levi, where the priests come from. And when John the Baptist arrives, he's talking about the kingdom to come. He's talking about the generation to come. He's talking about the Messiah, the coming Messiah. And he doesn't know it is his cousin, Jesus. Jesus is his cousin. He doesn't know that that is the Messiah that he was sent to proclaim. Yesterday I told you that the Torah used to be taught and read for about 3 years, and it was closed down for 6 months. And Jesus Christ, who is the revealed word, the manifested word, did his ministry for 3 years, and he died. But before he did that, John the Baptist came 6 months before him. Hallelujah. So when Jesus arrives at the waters to be baptized, and John the Baptist sees him, he says, "You need to baptize me, and you are coming to me." Many people thought that John the Baptist said it because he thought and he knew that Jesus is the Messiah. But listen to what John the Baptist said. He said, "I didn't know him. That's why I came baptizing. For he who sent me to baptize said unto me, upon whom ye shall see the Spirit of God descend and remain, even he is the Christ." So each time John the Baptist puts people in the water, he would watch to see if the Spirit will come. And when the Spirit did not come, he said, "Get out. Next. Get out. Next." The reason John the Baptist baptized was not because the baptism washed away sins. The baptism of John the Baptist did nothing. It was for him to see who was the Messiah, so he can know when his ministry is over. So when John the Baptist began to baptize people, he would look. But in this case, he had not yet baptized Jesus. So he couldn't have known that Jesus was the Messiah. So he said what he said because of the life that he knew Jesus lived. They were cousins. Jesus had never stolen. He had never lied. He had never manifested anger. He was always loving, good. By virtue of the lifestyle that John saw Jesus living, he said, "No, you were supposed to baptize me." Not because he knew he was the Messiah. Hallelujah. And you see, God had placed a curse on those who will not obey the law. And one of the curses in Deuteronomy 28 was that the heavens will become like brass. The heavens shall be closed. The heavens shall be shut. That generation had unbelief. They didn't have faith. So God took away the Sabbath from them. They couldn't rest 40 years in the wilderness. Hunger, test, trouble left and right, wars and battles. God said, "This rest, you will not see it. I'll keep it for a generation yet to come." Now Jesus enters the water, and John the Baptist says, "You need to baptize me." Jesus said, "No, do this to fulfill all righteousness. Let us fulfill all righteousness." You see, there was a prophecy hanging over the Messiah. A messianic prophecy said that he shall be a high priest unto God after the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek was both king and priest. And the kings only came from the tribe of Judah, and the priest came from the tribe of Levi. Jesus was born from the tribe of Judah. John was born from the tribe of Levi. So by no standard was Jesus qualified to be a priest, because he came from the tribe of Judah, where the kings come from. But in the baptism of John, listen, oh my goodness. John baptized people unto repentance. That's what the scripture says. And Jesus had never sinned. So he didn't need the baptism of John. It was not necessary. But why did he have to go there? It's because when John laid his hands on Jesus, it was an ordination. The priesthood left the house of Levi into the house of Judah. And that is what qualified Jesus to be both king and priest after the order of Melchizedek. So that ancient prophecy was fulfilled there. And when Jesus came up out of the water and was praying, the Bible says the heavens were opened. Hallelujah. Revoking the curse of Deuteronomy 28. So now the closed heaven became an open heaven. Amen. For the new generation. Because when you function under the open heaven, you do not struggle. When you move under an open heaven, you do not fight. You experience the rest of God. I'm taking you somewhere. Just follow me closely. That was a prophetic signal that the ministry of John the Baptist was over. Because he saw the Spirit of God come down in bodily form as a dove and rested upon Jesus. In the Old Testament, the Spirit rested on no one. It always came and left. The Spirit of God would come on Samson. He would destroy. Then the Spirit of God would depart. He would look for a prostitute. The Spirit of God always came and went. But this time, the Spirit came and remained. And a voice spoke from heaven, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." John the Baptist's ministry had to end there, but he kept on preaching. What was he preaching? The Messiah has been shown to you. He was supposed to join that church, Jesus' church, and become a deacon in the church. But he kept on preaching, and then he went into marriage counseling, and he lost his head. So Jesus came up out of the water and he starts his ministry at the age of 30. And in the realms of the spirit, he was proclaimed high priest, the high priest of God. Amen. Amen. And you see, the high priest never sat down. There was no chair in the tabernacle for the high priest. Like we have a chair in church for the pastor. In the tabernacle, there was no chair for the high priest. The high priest couldn't sit down because there was work. And as long as there was work, he couldn't rest. He had to burn the incense. He had to intercede for the tribes, for the families. He had to do this. He had to do that. He could not sit down. He could not rest. There was no chair for him because there was always work for him. So Jesus begins his ministry. He goes into the synagogue. Yesterday I showed you about the synagogue, the chair in the synagogue, right? Now we're looking at the tabernacle now. There was no chair there. But in the synagogue, there was a chair for the Messiah. So Jesus begins his priestly ministry. And the priest's ministry is to represent the people before God. But the prophet's ministry is to represent God before the people. So Jesus now becomes our representative in the realm of the spirit. And listen to what he does. Jesus goes into the temple, into the synagogue. Please read for me Mark chapter 3 from verse 1 to 6. In this scripture, Jesus sees a man in the synagogue who has a withered hand. And he says, and he entered again to the synagogue, and there was a man whose hand had been withered.
So they watched him closely.
Yes.
Whether he would heal him on the Sabbath so
yes.
that they might accuse him.
Yes.
And he said to the man who had the withered hand,
yes.
Step forward.
Step forward.
Then he said to them, "Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill?" But they kept silent.
They kept silent. They held their peace. Because Jesus knew that when the Sabbath comes, nobody should be sick. The Sabbath is a day for wholeness. Whatever is not complete has to be completed. Every project that is not perfected has to be completed. There's an anointing that is coming on you this night. Amen. This anointing will cause your hand to finish whatever you have started.
Amen.
And what God has begun in your life, he shall perfect it.
Amen.
That your amen is not born again at all.
Amen.
Is it lawful to do good on a Sabbath? Why should a man be sick on a Sabbath? Why should a man be broke on a Sabbath? And they kept their peace. And then Jesus said in Matthew 11:28, "Come unto me, all ye who are weary laden, heavy laden, and are weary, and I will give you rest." I want to give you rest. Jesus came to bring the rest. He came to bring the Sabbath. He says, "Come unto me, and I will give you rest."
Amen.
I will give you rest. And in chapter 17, from verse 1 to 6, chapter 17 of Matthew, verse 1 to 6, the Bible says, "After 6 days, Jesus chose Peter, James, and John, and he took them to a high mountain." After 6 days, what does that mean? In the seventh day, he chose Peter, James, and John, and he took them to a high mountain, and he was transfigured before them.
Yeah.
And Moses and Elijah appeared and discussed with him. And you know, Apostle Paul said something in the book of Romans, chapter 4. He says, a type of righteousness is being revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. The law is Moses. The prophet is Elijah. Mm-hmm. And so he talks with them. And Luke reveals to us that they were discussing about his exit at Jerusalem. That's what they were talking about. His departure. Talking about his death at Jerusalem. And after all of this had happened, Jesus came down from the mountain to meet the other disciples struggling to cast out one demon. Mm-hmm. Bartholomew said, this thing is in the head. Andrew said, no, we need to put more anointing oil. The way you have anointed that head is too small. They were arguing and struggling with a demon. Come out, I'll not come out. Come out, I'll not come out. Who are you? The demon, he said, I am. When Jesus shows up, he said, hey, bring him here. Devil, out, and do not enter him again. That's all. The Bible says the demon used to throw the boy into water and into fire to kill him. He had just had an encounter with Moses who divided the water and Elijah who called down fire. So he said, devil, check out. And they asked him, why could we not cast out the demon? He said, because of your unbelief. Where there is unbelief, there is unrest. Rest comes with faith. You can only experience rest when you activate faith and belief. I hear some preachers say, oh, you're going through the desert. You know, just keep going through the wilderness. Your wilderness will soon be over. I'm telling you, the wilderness, you need to go through the wilderness. I don't need to go through the wilderness. They went through wilderness because of unbelief. Canaan was few days' journey from Egypt. But because they couldn't trust God, he had to pass them through the desert. You would only experience a desert in the area of your life where you can't believe God. You would have a desert in the area of your life that you can't believe God. If you can't trust God for finances, if you can't trust God to pay your bills, you would have a desert. Financial desert is waiting for you. It's waiting for you. But you cannot rest financially. You can't drive the car you want to drive. You can't live in the house that you want to live in. But when you activate belief and faith, you enter financial rest. Deserts only come in the areas of your life where you can't believe God. Not everybody is born for the desert. I am not born for the desert. I thought you would say it with me. Say, I'm not born for the desert. Desert is for unbelievers. The Bible says they couldn't believe, so they didn't enter the rest. Hallelujah. So don't accept it. Even if the person who is preaching to you about going through the desert has is doctor. Desert is for unbelievers. It's not for you. Say, not for me. Say, not for me. So, after 6 days, Jesus selected 3 out of 12. Not everybody was called to this mountaintop experience. 3 out of 12 after 6 days. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a prophetic side to this scripture. There's a prophetic side to this scripture. The Bible tells us that a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years. And 1,000 years is as 1 day. Do you know that from the time of Adam to the time of Abraham was 2,000 years? 2,000 years. And from the time of Abraham to the time of Jesus Christ was another 2,000 years, making it 4,000 years. And from the time of Jesus to the year 2000, we're in 2016, to the year 2000 was another 2,000 years, making it how many years? 6,000 years. So when we entered 2001, we were in the after 6 days. Because we were in the 7,000th dispensation. That means that from the year 2001, something happened on earth. That was the year that people said the world was going to end. But they could not figure out that it was a year where there was a paradigm shift. You're not getting what I'm saying. The scientists could sense it. The astrologers could sense it. Even witches. They could sense it. There's something about 2001. But they didn't know what it was. We had entered into the 7,000th year. The seventh day of the Lord. So we are in 2016. We are 16 years into the seventh day. That means, as I'm talking to you right now, there is a selection taking place. And I've come to speak to a few. Whenever you see Christians gather in a church like this, don't be fascinated by the crowds that gather in our conferences. You watch the television, you see thousands of people in conferences, in churches. God is looking for the Peter, James, and the John. It's not everybody. There is an elect. God is calling for the glorious church to come out of the militant church. There is a glorious church and there's a militant church. The militant church is still struggling with demons, still fighting to have a breakthrough, still fighting to have a healing, still looking for a miracle. But the glorious church is walking in the victories of Christ. These are the more than conquerors. They have passed the level of fighting with fear. I'm not struggling with demons. I've passed that level. Are you getting what I'm saying? They are not struggling with poverty. They have passed that level. They are not struggling to get a healing. They have passed that level. These people don't fall sick. They are elders. He says, if any one of you is sick, let him call for the elders. The elders don't fall sick. And the elders of the church are not the gray-headed people. These are people who have mastered the word of God. They have tested the word of truth. Hallelujah. These are people, Ayakiba Shanda, who can speak like John. He says, what we testify is what our eyes have seen, our hands have touched, we have handled concerning the word of life. We know this thing. We have experienced it. We are not talking theology to you. We are speaking life. We have experienced it. Christ to us is a reality. I'm not telling you what somebody said. I'm telling you what I have seen. Hallelujah. Amen. The glorious church. It's time for the glorious church to stand up. Amen. Let's not waste our time with the militant people. These are people who are in church for healing and prophecy. I told myself today, I said, Father, please, I don't want to prophesy today. We prophesied yesterday. We called names of people. We called states, place, dates of birth, all of that. No, tonight, please, Father, help us to teach. Hallelujah. Amen. You see, the militant church doesn't know. Hey, this thing will help us. Can I say something? Yes. The Christian doesn't need healing. The Christian doesn't need a miracle. Because it is their inheritance. Good health is your inheritance. You are praying for healing. Oh Lord, please heal me. Father, please heal me. This pain. You know this pain has been here for so many. Father, no, you don't need a healing. Good health is your inheritance. It's your right. You don't ask for it, you take it. You take it. So there's a selection going on. And I have come this night to speak to Peter, James, and John. I don't know if they're present here tonight. But the Peter, the James, and the John are shouting hallelujah right now. He took them to a high mountain. Talking about a mountaintop experience. You see, you don't have a barrenness problem. You have a level problem. It's where you are looking at it from the valley or from the mountain. When you are in an aircraft, the houses that look so gigantic become like ants because you have changed the level, the angle of perception. Just like David. David didn't fight Goliath from the earth. He fought Goliath from the spirit realm. So he was able to see the ant in the giant. You know the word ant is in the word giant. There is an ant in giant. So he looked at it from that perspective. And God is calling us tonight to come to a higher level. Leave the little things. Leave those things. Come out from the valley. Come to the mountaintop where you have real experiences with God. Are you getting what I'm saying? More than 80% of the church does not know God. We don't know God. More than 80% of Christians today don't know God. We know the church of God, but we don't know the God of the church. Because we've not had a mountaintop experience. Touch your neighbor, say, come up hither. Come up hither. Say, come up hither. Touch your second neighbor, say, come up. Come up hither. Leave the valley. Come to the mountain. Hallelujah. I'm not preaching to you because I went to Bible school or I've read a lot of books. I'm preaching to you what I have tasted, what I have seen, what I've experienced. Hallelujah. Please get a place of encounter with Jesus. Come to know him personally. Come to know him personally. You know, there are Christians who have never heard the voice of God and they are not bothered. They see eat hamburger and eat shrimps and but they've never heard the voice of God. They are not troubled at all. Something is wrong. You can't call God your father and you don't know his voice. That means you are living in a neighbor's house. Hallelujah. Come to the mountain and stay there. And if we are in the 7,000 year dispensation, it means we are in the dispensation of rest. In 2016, you shouldn't be walking up and down and walking yourself up. You should have rest. Touch your neighbor, say rest. We have limited rest to dead people. Rest in peace. Rest in peace. You have to rest. Because if you don't rest, you will rest in pieces. So Jesus came to introduce us to the real Sabbath of the Lord. And when he is taken to the cross to be crucified, Mark chapter 15 reveals to us that he was crucified at the third hour and he died at the ninth hour. He spent 6 hours on the cross. But when the seventh hour arrived, he said, into thy hands I commit my spirit. It is finished. And he rested. For each hour on that cross, there was a representation of each day in the first creation. God spent 6 days in the first creation. Jesus spent 6 hours for the new creation. If any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. The old took 6 days. The new took 6 hours. There's an anointing in Christ to compress your struggle. What you're supposed to achieve in 6 years, in the next 6 weeks, it can happen to you. You don't understand what I'm saying. Now I am already prophesying. This is another level of prophecy. This is another level of prophecy. That in the next 6 weeks, what took people 6 years in America can happen to you in 6 weeks. And I prophesy in the name of Jesus, 6 weeks from now, what has taken other 6 years shall happen in your life. It shall happen in your life. Lift your hand and shout hallelujah. I believe God. Now, if you don't have faith there, if you don't believe it, you may have a desert. But if you believe it, shout, I believe. Say, I receive acceleration in the name of Jesus. Please be seated. There's an anointing in Christ. There's an anointing in Christ to compress struggle, to reduce it to zero. When Jesus died, he went to hell. How many of you know Jesus went to hell? And I went to hell in Jesus. All of us have been to hell. I hope you know that. Except if you are not born again, you have to go to hell for yourself. That's why when an unbeliever dies, he goes to hell. Christians don't go to hell because they've already been to hell. All have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Then he said, the wages of sin is death. Romans 6:23. So everybody who has sinned has to go to hell. You have sinned before. I've sinned before. All have sinned. That means everybody must go to hell. Everybody. But if I have believed in Jesus, then he has taken the punishment for my sin already. Every punishment God should have given you for the wrongs you have done, he has given Jesus. I marvel when I see Christians say, this thing I'm going through, God is trying to punish me. God is trying to teach me a lesson. I lived a bad life. So God is, no, all your punishment he put on Jesus. That's the beauty of Christianity. Oh, I'm sorry for the Muslims. I'm sorry for the Buddhists. I'm sorry for the Hindus. There's no one to redeem them if they don't accept Jesus. Jesus took the punishment, and I took the punishment in Christ. So I have been to hell. So I went to hell in Boeing 316. John 316. That was the Boeing 316. 316. And we didn't have a one-way ticket. It was a two-way ticket. Because I went with Jesus as my pilot. But a man who has not believed in Christ has a one-way ticket to hell. He goes there and he's not coming back. And how long is hell? Hell is for how long? When you go to hell, it's for how long? 50 years? 100 years? Hell is for how long? Eternity. When you enter hell, you don't come out. Judas is still there till today. Iscariot. Judas and his carrot, they're still in hell today. He's eating his carrot in hell. He's in hell till today. Till today, he's in hell. But I know a man who entered hell. Hell was supposed to be for eternity. He compressed eternity into 3 days. What should have taken a lifetime was finished in 3 days. I don't know how long you have suffered, though. Maybe what you have been suffering has lasted for 20 years or 15 years. In the next 30 minutes, as you are hearing my voice, every situation is arrested. Every condition is reversed. Every curse is broken in the name of Jesus. The devil is a liar. I said the devil is a liar. Eternity compressed in 3 days. 3 days. What should have taken long? I keep getting this thing in my spirit. Something that should have taken long will be completed in few days. I speak with my eyes open and my eyes closed. What should have taken you so long? Within the next few days, it shall be completed. It shall be completed. That deal shall be signed. That contract shall be signed. That job shall be given. That money shall be paid. That house shall be bought. In the name of Yeshua. There's an anointing in Christ. There's an anointing in Christ. There's a grace in Christ. Oh, hallelujah. There is a grace in Christ. This ministry will grow fast. What took Ora Roberts years will take this church very few years. It is going to happen. Yes, the Lord has opened the floodgates over Living World. Yes, the Lord has touched this church. The finger of the Lord has come upon you. The hand of God has come upon you. What has taken the fathers of faith centuries, it won't take you time. I say it won't take you time. We are of a different dispensation. I said we are of a different dispensation. We are the generation of the Lord's rest. We are the generation of the Lord's rest. Hallelujah. Jesus said to them, if you have faith, if you have faith as a mustard, if you have, that was before he died. But when Jesus resurrected, it was different. This generation is no longer if you have faith. We are born with faith. Because we are saved by grace through faith. We have faith. Ah, my God. Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 12, he says, God has given to every man among you the measure of faith. Amen. You have, I say you have faith. Amen. I say you have faith. Amen. I say you have faith. Amen. Touch your neighbor, say, I have faith.
I have faith.
There's nobody in this hall tonight that lacks faith. Every one of us has faith. Because you have the measure of faith. And the faith you have is the God kind of faith.
Amen.
It's the same faith that God had when he looked at the universe and it was dark and formless. And he said, let there be light. And there was light. You have that faith. You have that faith. Ah, yeah, 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 yeah. I said you have that faith. You can look at your situation. No money in your bank account. And you say, let there be. Let there be. You have that faith. Let there be church growth. Let there be expansion. Let there be multiplication. Let there be increase in leaps and bounds. Let there be. Let there be. You have faith. I said you have faith. What is faith? The best definition is in Hebrews chapter 11 from verse 1. He says, now faith. It's just like you say, you have black jacket. We have white shirt. We have red chair. You have gray carpet. You have now faith. There is a now faith. He says, now faith is a substance of things hoped for. My God. And the evidence of things not seen. He says faith is a substance. It's something you can touch. It's something you can feel. Faith is not a mental asset. It is touchable. It is tangible. It is physical. He says faith is the substance. Listen to this. Please have your seat for a few minutes. Faith is the substance, brother, of things hoped for. Hope is in past tense. In past tense. That means when faith appears, hope disappears. Hope ceases to be. Okay, I hoped for a bottle of water. I was hoping. I didn't have it. I was hoping. He says, when faith comes, it is the substance of things hoped for. I'm no longer hoping. Now, many people think that the opposite of faith is fear. I will shock you tonight. The opposite of fear, of faith, is not fear, is hope. The opposite of faith is hope, not fear. Fear is faith in worry. If a doctor tells you are sick, you're HIV positive, and you are afraid, you believe the report. You have faith in what he has said. But the opposite of faith is not fear, it's hope. Because hope tells you, wait, it is coming. Faith tells you, it has come. Faith is the substance of things we have hoped for. When faith is alive, I'm no longer hoping. You can't say, I have faith to get the job. Wrong. You can't have faith to get. You are still in hope. Now, many people are in hope and they think they have faith. And they are wondering why they are still going through deserts. Okay, you've been looking for a baby for long. You want to get a child. You know what you should do? Go and buy the baby clothing. They will see you in the shop, in the shopping mall, at the baby section, picking the pink. It's a girl. You're picking the blue. It's a boy. Then you are taking both of them. It's twin, girl and a boy. They say, sister, are you okay? Are you pregnant? Tell her, yes, I'm okay. This is substance. I'm getting substance. Substance of things we hoped for. This is substance. Something you can touch. The baby clothing. That is a substance. It's physical. It's a sign. Hallelujah. Are you pregnant? No. Why are you buying the baby is coming? How? Faith is foolishness to them that are natural. Till you are called foolish, you don't have faith. Oh, I have some crazy testimonies. I may not have time to share with you. Crazy testimonies. Crazy. Like driving a car without gas. You put water inside. This is fuel. You are in the middle of nowhere. There's no gas station. And you need to get to where you're going to. Huh. Crazy testimonies. People who have done crazy stuff. Go and listen to me. You're planning for your wedding. I prophesied to you the other day. You know what you should do? Don't sit down and wait for the man to come before. Listen. Don't wait for the man to come before you start thinking which wedding gown you would have on that day. Go to online shopping right now. Start checking. That is substance. That is substance. Go to the car dealership. Look for where they sell cars. What is your dream car? Walk into that place with your hands in the pockets. You say, who is in charge here? How much is this Lamborghini? Okay. How much is the Ferrari? Get me the key. You get into the car. You boom, 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 boom. This is good. Then you come out and you say, all right, I will take this one. I love this one. I'll be back. I will be back. And then you behave as a man who owns a Lamborghini. You don't talk like a person who is still struggling to survive. Are you getting what I'm saying? You are not broke. You've not activated your faith. That's the problem. You've not activated your faith. You've not. Go and price it. How much is this house? I see the house on sale. All right. Keep it. I'll be back. Touch your neighbor. Say, I'll be back. Look for a better neighbor. Say, I'll be back. Because without faith, you will sit down and be thinking, how do I have a house? How will I ever have a house? You'll be worried. You'll be troubled. You see others with their good houses, good cars, good marriages. You'll be troubled. You'll be going through a desert situation. But when you have faith, it lifts you up. Faith is a force that attracts to you what you have hoped for. What you have hoped for. Hope ceases to be when faith arrives. You can't hope with faith. The two of them can't coexist. It's like trying to put light and darkness together. It doesn't work. It's the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I don't see it, but I can prove it. It is there. I can prove it is there. When God sent me to begin our ministry, Light World Mission International Church, man of God, there was no member. Our church started in a garage. Beside the market. And our markets are not like your malls here. It's real markets. It's muddy. It's mushy. It's anyhow. Amen. That's where we started the church. But that's where God lives anyway. Because in the beginning the earth was void and formless. But God was there. The Spirit of God was moving there. So we started there with three members. Three women. Always women. You know, when women stand, when you see women in the church has a future. I'm serious. So one day, nobody came. and I had to preach, I had prepared a sermon about the Holy Spirit. I had prayed for hours. I prayed for 6 hours that day for the service. And I went out, put the chairs, and I waited, and nobody came. I said, God, didn't you send me? People were laughing at me. I had invited people. Nobody came. I took stones. You know stones? I took stones, many of them, and I placed them in front of me. And in my mind, I saw Rehab Bunker Crusade, where you have heads of thousands of people. And I stood there, and I was preaching to stones. I'm telling you my life story. I preached to stones. God is going to bless you. God is going to change you. The Holy Ghost is alive. And there was no amen, but I had thousands of amen in my spirit. I knew where I was going to. I knew where I was going to. My family rejected me for 3.5 years. I slept on the streets. Hey. No money. Nobody gave me anything. And I asked from no one. I was going somewhere. I had evidence of things not seen. While I was preaching to those stones, I saw you. Look at, I'm preaching to you today. But I was preaching to stones back in the day. Hallelujah. Amen. Now that same church, we are in different countries of the world. We are in Ivory Coast. We are in Johannesburg. We are in Central Africa. We are in Chad. We are in Maryland. And we have spread. And we are thousands. Amen. Amen. So you see, in my spirit, I saw thousands. I had the evidence. My preaching did not change. I preached as if I was talking to thousands, but they were stones. I finished. I collected offering. I prayed over the offering myself. I put the offering in and I collected it. Then I counted the offering. I had one pair of trousers I wore. One pair of pants I wore. Hi. There were days when I took water. I blessed and I said, Father, thank you for this rice. But it was water. I drank it. And I thank God for rice. Fried rice. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I don't see. There's so many things that this issue of faith. I have seen it, brother. It works. It works. How many of you have faith tonight? See. With faith, you won't worry. You won't worry. You won't think, how would the food come? How would the bills be paid? You won't. You won't. I've seen crazy miracles, money appearing in my account. Money. Money appears, and it will happen tonight. I perceive it. I have that ability. To multiply cash. Amen. And as I'm talking to you, money is multiplying in your account. Amen. Yes. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. You will have a bank alert very soon. Watch your cell phone. You will have a bank alert very soon. I activate it. Amen. Now in the name of Jesus. Let me round off this teaching. Let me round it off. Listen to this. There are certain things Jesus said before the cross that are no longer valid after the cross because the audience is not the same. Before he died, he said, ask, it shall be given. Seek, you shall find. And the church is still using that. He was talking to Old Testament folks. In the New Testament, we don't ask to receive. We don't seek to find. Listen, Peter says his divine power has given us everything we need. So I am not on the asking line. I am on the Lambano line. On the receiving line. So I don't say, Father, please give me a job. Father, please, oh God, please. If you give me a job, I will serve you. Please give me a job. I'm not on that line. I am on the other line where I say, Father, thank you that you give me a job. I receive this job right now. This job is mine. I claim it in the name of Jesus. You are not going for an interview to see if you can have the job. You are going for a confirmation that the job is yours. You get the job on your knees and you go to that office for confirmation. That's how it works. I've come to provoke you. You are carrying a weapon that you are not using. Activate your faith. Turn your faith button on. Hallelujah. And Jesus comes out from the grave. You know, there were two ascensions of Jesus. Jesus comes out from the grave and Mary Magdalene meets him. He says, don't touch me. I've not ascended to my Father yet. But go and tell my disciples and Peter. Go and tell my disciples and Peter. Was Peter not part of the disciples? Why should he separate Peter from the disciples? He says, tell my disciples and Peter. Why? Because Peter by this time had denied Jesus. And by mere confession that I do not know him, he had extracted his name from the list of the disciples. It is your words. Faith is an expression in words and in deed. Faith is an action. Faith is acting on what you believe. Now, let me say this. There's a difference between believing and having faith. Belief is a strong conviction, but faith is acting on that strong conviction. The woman with the issue of blood said, if I can but touch the hem of his garment, I shall be healed. But she was still sick. Because it was just a conviction. She just believed that if I touch, I will be well. But as long as she did not touch, that belief couldn't heal her. She was still sick. She had to get up from her house and go to where Jesus was preaching. And as soon as she touched, Jesus said, your faith has made you well. She acted on what she believed. What do you believe? What do you believe? Don't wait for the way to be open before you advance. Advance, the way will open. Don't wait for money to start the project. Start the project, the money will come. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Start the project. Plan it. Oh, I'm waiting to get some money, then I get married. No. Start planning the wedding. The money will come. That's how God functions. You confess it. Go and tell my disciples and Peter that I've ascended to my Father and their Father. To my God and their God. And Jesus went up and he came back again and said, touch me. For spirit has no flesh and bone. Give me some fish. Ate it. Stayed with them for 40 days. Teaching them how the glorified Christ should operate. How the new creation functions. The new creation is not limited by walls. Jesus just walked into their midst. The doors were shut. That is to tell you that this new creation generation, nothing can stop us. Amen. It's a generation that goes through walls. What has stopped others can stop us. Amen. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
You are different. Yes. You are not like your colleagues. You are different. Tell your neighbor, I am different. So Jesus ascends into heaven. What is the first thing Jesus does when he enters heaven? He sits down at the right hand of the Father. The high priest, as long as there was work, couldn't sit down. But when the Bible specifies that Jesus is seated, have you heard people say that he's seated at the right hand of God? What's the meaning of seated? It's a sign that the work is finished. The high priest could not sit down as long as there was work. But the Bible says Jesus entered heaven and sat down at the right hand of the Father. So there's no work left to be done. Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me. There's nothing you have to do. Just find out what has been done and take advantage of it. That's all. Jesus won't come and die again for anybody's sins. He's done it once and for all. Everything he has done is eternal. Forgiveness is eternal. The sins you commit tomorrow, forgiveness has been provided in case you sin. But you are not going to sin. Because when you sin, you put yourself in a place where the enemy can get you. But provision has been made for forgiveness. In case, just in case. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So take advantage of that tonight. Brother, there's nothing you are looking for which God has not yet given you. Can I have a child? Let me close with this demonstration. Yes, come with that baby. A child that is not working. Do we have a child that is still very small? Thank you. Come. Wow. Do human beings walk? Do human beings walk? Can this baby walk? How many of you say yes? How many of you say no? Okay. How many of you say I don't know? Tell me. All right. This is a baby, right? Is this baby a human being?
Yes.
Do human beings walk?
Yes.
Can the baby walk?
Yes.
Okay. Is the baby walking?
No.
Do human beings talk?
Yes.
Jesus, looking at me. Can the baby talk? Okay, is the baby talking?
No.
So is the baby a human being?
Yes.
Now you're contradicting yourself. I've asked you, do human beings talk? You said yes. Can the baby talk?
Yes.
Is the baby talking?
No.
You said no. Is the baby a human being?
Yes.
But do human beings talk?
Yes.
Is the baby talking? Is the baby a human being?
Yes.
That's another dimension, please. Listen to this. Though this baby cannot talk, cannot walk now, in this baby is the ability to walk. In this baby is the ability to speak. This one will sing. The ability is in the child. But as she exercises that ability, it grows. She has the potential to walk and to talk, though she's not using it yet, but it is in her to walk and to talk. All right. Do I have a multi-millionaire here in dollars? All right. Do you have millions of dollars in your account now? Are you getting the message now?
Yes.
Do you have $1 billion in your account now?
Yes.
Can you show me the $1 billion? You may not see it, but in you, it's an ability. Kaba Shadaba. I say in you, there's an ability to produce billions of dollars. You have it inside you. You need to activate it. You need to turn your faith button on. You need to take some steps. And when that baby begins to take some steps, it may fall. But it does not remain on her knees. She gets up. She takes other steps. She may fall. But she does not remain on the floor. You keep trying. Faith is an action. I say faith is an action. Don't be afraid to fail. Don't be afraid to fall. Just be afraid to stand still. Whatever it takes, keep moving. Whether you crawl or you walk, keep moving. Are you hearing what I'm saying? From this night, refuse to be stagnant. From this night, refuse to remain in one position. Hallelujah. Enter into rest. I say enter into rest. Oh, when your faith is activated, you are in rest. You can sleep well. I say you can rest well. You have been called to sit down. You have been called to sit down. From today, when you see a chair, sit and remember that you are seated together with Christ in heavenly places. Your work is finished. You have been called into a dancing life, into a shouting life. Stand to your feet and shout hallelujah. Stand to your feet and shout hallelujah. Amen. Amen. You have been called into a life of glory. You have been called into a life of honor. You have been called into a life of rest. From this night, wipe away your tears. From this night, you shall not eat bread at the sweat of your forehead. No, no, no. That was the curse of Adam. But we are in Christ. I say it is finished. I say it is over. When Christ took the crown of thorns, he reversed the curse of the thorns and thistles. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So you shall no longer eat from the sweat of your head. No, 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 no. It's no more labor. It's now favor. I say it's no longer labor. It's now favor. Lift your hand and say, Father, I believe. Father, I receive. I am blessed to be a blessing. I am blessed to be a blessing. I am the blessed of God. I am the healed of God. I am the righteousness of God. In the name of Jesus, I am the light of the world. I am a God representative. I am a manifestor of power. I'm a demonstrator of the Spirit of God. I'm a carrier of divine presence. I'm a transporter of divine grace. I'm a communicator of divine wisdom. I'm a proclaimer of divine truth. I am a liberator for my generation. In the name of Jesus, I take my place. I enter into rest. I cease to worry. I cease to fear. My faith is working. My faith is activated. In the name of Jesus, there is life in me. There is good health in me. I do not die, but I live to proclaim the goodness of God. No weapon formed or fashioned against me shall be able to prosper. Every tongue that rises against me in judgment, I condemn it. In the name of Jesus, I am the workmanship of God, created in Christ for good works, which he ordained that I should walk in it. I am a royal priesthood. I am a chosen one. I am a blessed nation. I am a holy nation. Holy unto the Lord, sanctified for his glory, dedicated to his purpose, called for his honor. In the name of Jesus, I am strong. I am not weak. I am blessed. I am prosperous. I am the son of the I am. I am the daughter of the I am. So I therefore declare, I am prosperous. I am victorious. I am more than conquerors. I am rich. I am forgiven. I am a new creation. I am blessed. Blessed in every work. My hands are blessed. My job is blessed. My body is blessed. Wherever I go, the blessing follows me. In the name of Jesus, I decree and declare, supernatural help is coming to me now. Helpers of my destiny are coming to me now. My name, my image carries favor, carries favor, carries favor, carries favor. In the name of Jesus, I am attracting to myself men and women relevant to my destiny. I am attracting to myself all the resources and the finances that I need in this season. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Shout amen. Hallelujah. Whoa. Kaba Shagabaya. How do you feel inside? There's a champion in you that is rising. There's a giant in you that is rising. I'm telling you, all you sisters, it's not time to sit somewhere and be having a pity party for yourself. That time is past. As you walk out of this church tonight, walk out with your head high. Are you getting what I'm saying? You chin up and you square up. You put some bouncing in your legs. Put some springs in your legs. Hallelujah. You are blessed to be a blessing. Wave your hands and thank Him for what He has done. Thank Him. Say, Father, I thank You that I receive. Thank You that I receive healing right now. I receive blessings right now. Direction. I receive vision right now. I receive vision. I receive vision. I receive vision. Thank You, Jesus.